Everyone, thank you for being here tonight for a very, very special event. We're very lucky to have Ananda Devi with us tonight. I'm Lili Chopra, the programming director here at FIAF, and we have the wonderful Professor Thomas Peer here, who will actually introduce us, Ananda Devi. Thomas Peer is professor of French at Lehman College and the Graduate Center of CUNY, and founder of the wonderful website Île en Île that I would really urge you all to look at. We need to thank for tonight's event la Délégation Générale des Alliances Françaises, as well as the Organisation Internationale de la Francophonie. So we'll have about 45 minutes of interview by Thomas Peer of Ananda Devi, and then we'll open the session to questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Bonsoir. Hello. And welcome. It's certainly important to thank our the people who are sponsoring us this evening. Thank you, Florence Cave-Wasserman and Lili Chopra, the Alliance Française, and welcome, Ananda, to New York.
Thank you.
Welcome to the Alliance Française. I don't know if there's you know, colleagues and members of the Alliance Française here, students. I don't know if you perhaps prefer being in France rather than selling in promoting your work out here, but I think one thing that we had mentioned earlier was that Île Maurice is so little known by Americans, and I thought one of the questions that I would ask to begin is, on the website Île en Île, we present that you were born in a field of sugarcane, and I guess the question is the place of Mauritius in what we call la francophonie. Some of us, like myself, don't like to use that word, but and I'm thinking of some television interviews that I've seen with you where you see often the colonials, the ex-colonials. I remember an interview about 2 years ago when it was the year of the francophonie in France, and you were on a television show with all these people who had a chip on their shoulders. They had something against France. There was Calix Béla, who you might know from Cameroon, who was all revolted. There was Daniel Maximin, they're screaming, Alain Mabankou. And other than the Paul Tierno Monenembo, who was rather cool, there was you, very calm. And I was wondering if you could say that, is Mauritius, the place of Francophonie for Mauritius, is it because you had 100 years of the English colonialism as well, that you're not... You're more calm in your francophonie?
Well, yes, I think that it was an interesting program on television, because I was probably the only one who said about three words in during the whole program, and there were about eight other people shouting and about things. I must say that, first of all, for me, language is not a sort of flag that you wave to fight something, to fight. Language is something that you hold and nurture, and that you want to really belong to yourself. So if you're writing in a language, you don't want to fight either with that language or even for that language. It's not a fight. It's something that you want to be just you. You don't want to have any issues about it. It's just you, part of you, and you carry on your work in that language. So for me, French is a bit that. It's the language in which I am as a writer. So full stop, you know. So the whole issue of colonialism and all that is something that comes sort of from the outside, and that I'm asked to comment upon. And to talk about the situation of Mauritius with regard to French, it's a very special relationship that Mauritius has And it's perhaps the, I think, as far as I know, it's the only country in the world where it is said that English is losing ground to French, and that some people have to think that they have to defend English because it's being lost. So perhaps so it has a special place in the Francophonie. I think that the reason for that is that during French colonialism, there was much more interpenetration of the French culture with the population, with the local cultures, with the people that remained. For example, the first newspapers were created during French colonial rule, and these newspapers have sort of survived over time. And when the English fought with the French for sort of for Mauritius, for possession of Mauritius, the reason for that being that before the Suez Canal was opened, all the ships who were going on the spice trade to India, to China, had to go around Africa, around the Horn of Africa, and Mauritius, being in the middle of the, in the Indian Ocean, was a key supply point for the ships going around Africa from Europe and going towards Asia. So the motto of Mauritius has remained even today the star and key of the Indian Ocean, and that the key of the Indian Ocean that comes from that time during colonialism, early colonialism, before the opening of Suez Canal, when it was a key supply point. So that's why the British and French fought for control of Mauritius and Réunion. And Réunion Island remained French, and Mauritius became English. But the last 100 years or so of British colonialism, the British were very much sort of aloof from the society. They ruled, but they were not part of the society. They had their enclave where they lived. And for this reason, I think that, among many reasons, English was language of sort of officialdom. It was the language of the sort of constitution, language that remained sort of used for the more for official purposes than for daily use. So even during English colonial rule, French remained very much in a presence in Mauritius, and Creole, of course, which is the language that came out from from slavery, basically. It's when the French, during the French colonialism, when they started the sugarcane plantations in Mauritius, they had to bring in slave labor from Africa. And to communicate with that slave labor, the sort of masters and the slaves had to find a common ground to communicate, and all Creoles, actually, even in Haiti, in Seychelles, in Guadeloupe, in the Caribbean, the Creoles became the language of communication between the slaves and the masters. So the Creole that we have in Mauritius is very much French derived, and it's the lingua franca in Mauritius, and French is the other language that's most spoken and certainly most understood by all Mauritians, and English comes third. So it's a bit of a strange relationship that we have with French. But I'm sort of, in a way, yes, I started using French as a writer as a child. So I didn't know anything about this colonial relationship that we had with the language. So for me, the language became mine before I was aware of the political implications. And so I didn't have all this sort of fight with languages that other writers have. And in a way, it was lucky for me that I started writing so young, because first of all, I thought that to be a writer, you just had to write, you know. So it was, I didn't realize how hard it is to be a writer. So I just started writing without even realizing that it was something special. And when I realized it was something special, I would say it was too late, but it was my luck that it happened that way, that I started writing in a state of innocence, let's say, both towards language and towards the act of writing, which is far from innocent, of course.
There was a question also, because we are at the Alliance Française, and the idea that we're speaking in English, and perhaps I could throw that question out. I mean, we can remain in English. I don't usually speak with Ananda in English, but I guess I could ask quickly, are there people in the room who don't understand French? We continue in English? Just if you'd raise your hand if you don't. Okay, so we'll continue in English. It's okay. We'll perhaps do some reading in French in a moment. I would like to follow up on the question about Creole, though, because in a sense, you know, you're perhaps typically Mauritian in that Mauritians speak at least three or four languages. And what I found there is that it seems that the English is so much a language of business and the government, and French is the language of the daily newspapers and so much the language of literary creation. And there's so many other languages, Hindi, Urdu, Hakka, Bhojpuri. And the one language that everyone speaks is Creole. And when you speak of your mother tongue is Telugu. And your mother tongue, and then you have your Creole and the French and English that you learn in school, because French is not taught in the schools. And I guess the question for me, because we have very many Haitians, for example, in New York, and Mauritius has been independent since 1968, mm-hmm. and you know, 1.4 million people, and you are of that generation. You are the first generation of the independent Mauritians. Do you feel, I mean, where do you feel with the language, the Creole language? Is there a problem, the fact that it's not taught in the schools? Are you sorry that you didn't learn to write Creole, but you can write Creole? I mean, how do you feel with your national language is Creole, so how do you mm-hmm. feel with that as far as a writing instrument and a speaking instrument?
Well, it's a very complex issue. And to come back to what you said about the mother tongue, you said, you know, your mother tongue is Telugu. And I have to sort of go back on sort of my autobiography in a way, because it's true that my mother, literally my mother's tongue was Telugu, and she did speak the language to us, which is a language of South India, which is where my sort of forefathers or sort of great-grandparents came from. And so my mother did speak this language to us when I was very small, but we also spoke Creole. My father didn't speak Telugu, so he spoke Creole. We heard in the village where I lived, we heard Creole, Bhojpuri, the Indian languages, and we are taught French, yeah, from the early sort of schooling onwards. So both French and English are taught in Mauritius at school. But not Creole. So it's sort of a mixture of languages that are within our reach. And it so happened that when I started going to school, I started immediately speaking French, you know, and coming back home and answering to my mother in French when she was speaking to me in Telugu. So that finally they gave up, let's say my mother and my father gave up and started speaking French at home. And this is how in a way, I lost her language. I lost my mother tongue because of this situation that we have of multilingualism. And I only realized fully what it means to lose your mother's tongue when my mother passed away. And suddenly I realized, you know, that I have no chance of getting it back. And it's something that hits you when you're an adult, not as a child. You don't, as I said before, you don't worry about languages when you're a child. As an adult, you suddenly realize that it's a sort of void inside yourself or emptiness when you don't. Somebody asks you, "What's your mother tongue?" and you're sort of, you know, speechless in a way. And I tend to say that Creole is my mother tongue, but when I say that, I immediately feel a bit like a sort of something telling me, well, you know, that's not quite true. So it sort of feels there is an uneasiness with regard to this idea of mother tongue. I think for most Mauritians who don't use Indian languages as an active language in their daily life. But recently, well, this is of course a question that's asked constantly of me, you know, why do you write in French? What is your mother tongue, and et cetera. So it means that I constantly have to explain and why I write in French. And recently there was a newspaper in France who asked me to write precisely an article about that. And I was thinking about this issue of this relationship that I had and how I lost this language of my sort of ancestors and my mothers. And suddenly a sort of a complete sentence came back to me which I hadn't even recalled before. And this sentence was, it's a very short sentence, and it's Renu Kalamuti Sikra. And I was called Renu at home, and it literally means go and fetch the pen. And then suddenly I thought, just writing this article, I said that sentence, and I said, well, in a way I have obeyed this injunction of my mother's of fetching the pen, and I've used it also all my life, so I haven't quite sort of betrayed her as much as I sometimes think I have, and it's strange how these things suddenly come back from the subconscious. And so I think probably I haven't lost it really, it's buried somewhere in my subconscious, and perhaps this is why also writing is a state of tension also. You have to be in that state of tension to be able to pull something from language, to make it do what you want it to do, or to take you where you're not expecting to go. And I think that a lot of so-called francophone, between quotes, writers have a strange relationship with language, so with French, and they do try to pull it in different places and to create something out of it that's their own. And when you think of contemporary French writers who are from France, like Welbeck, Michel Welbeck, for example, is very famous, very well known, what he wants to do is to sort of avoid style in a way, to write as simply as possible without any stylistic effects. And for me, it sort of probably comes from the fact that he has no issues with that language. It's just, so he wants to something to be said in an immediate way without language distracting you from what he wants to say. Whereas for me, it's a language that I want to use to its in its fullness and use words and create a music with that language, which is probably not exactly the French music. It's a music of languages that come from different places. And in the end, it's something that's mine and that's my own.
I would never dare ask you why you write in French, because that's that horrible question that's, you know, why do you play piano and not the violin? But, but you do have a doctorate in ethnology, and again, we don't usually speak in English, but you can. And my question is there a difference in scientific writing? Because most of your ethnographic studies have been written in English. And is there something that you've, does the French give you something different than English does in your writing? And I think of this because you had told me once that there was a character that came to you named Egg, and it's like, the character was named Egg and you had to write in English. How does the language come to you, and is there a difference for you when you write scientific articles, or now you're basically writing only fiction, I believe, those two languages specifically?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's true that, basically the system of education in Mauritius is an English system of education. So I did do all my studies in English, but at the same time I was writing in French. So basically I was living in several languages, but mainly in these two languages. And when I went to do my studies in England, I realized that, and for a while when I went out of Mauritius to Britain to study, I stopped writing for a while, although I was writing constantly as a teenager before going to university. And I think it was a kind of break, both from my own country going to Europe, but also the change of in the language, linguistic environment. And when I was writing my thesis, my tutor was saying to me, well, what is your real language? And I sort of said, I don't know, you know. And he said, what do you count in? I said, I count in French. And he said, what do you dream in? I said, I don't know what I dream in any language. But I do think that it's sort of probably different parts of the brain that are used in the sort of academic writing and in literary writing. Because for me, somebody was asking me today, a student, she said, you've described yourself as a poet, but you've written much more prose than poetry, than books of poetry. And yet, it's true, I do say I feel like a poet, because even the prose I write is close to poetry. So when I write prose, I'm listening to an inner voice. It's not as if I'm thinking of each sentence and writing it down. I'm just letting the flow of the words and the music of the words attract each other and create something, some images. So to me, that link with the subconscious, at the moment when you put something on paper, occurs in French. And I've sort of rewritten myself or translated myself into English, but it's an act of recreation from an existing creation. So I think this does seem to suggest that French is the language of that comes from the heart, from the immediacy of creation. But as for explaining why it was French and not English when we learned both from the start, it's very difficult for me to say. Maybe because Creole is closer to French, so as a child you sort of want to go towards the language of reading and writing that is closer to what you hear in your daily life. Or it's just chance, just coincidence, I don't know. And occasionally, at some points in my path, I did think, well, maybe it would have been better if I was writing in English, because it would have been easier, perhaps, to be accepted as a writer. I don't know. But anyway, now I don't regret at all writing in French. But so I think that maybe it's different parts of the brain that write academic papers and poetry. They're not the same language, certainly.
Some of the people in the room may know that 2 years ago there was a manifesto published in Le Monde, which created lots of people talking about Pour une littérature monde en français. And you were one of the signatories of this manifesto. There were 44 writers who wrote for une littérature monde en français. And rather than getting into the great debate over that, I think that what is interesting with you is the parcours, the path that you've led from different publishing houses. You began publishing in Mauritius. Your first novel was published in Abidjan, and you went from L'Armatan to Dapper to Gallimard. And I think my question with the Pour une littérature monde en français is how many French people know Mauritian literature? And the question about Pour une littérature monde is do you feel there is a circulation of books? Do the Mauritians get texts from elsewhere? Do you feel that Mauritian literature that is published in Vacois or elsewhere in I mean, what for you was behind that signatory, and whether that has anything to do with, is there a potential for a literature mode as far as a real exchange of texts themselves in the countries of the French-speaking world?
Well, there are two aspects in this question, and one is about the reception, how the French literary world receives writers from elsewhere, let's say. And the other is a question which is much more economic, let's say, which is about distribution of books. And these are two issues that are very, very important for African literature or Indian Ocean literature, etc. The idea behind this manifesto was that although it looks as if, you know, a lot of writers from elsewhere, as I said, are being published in France, there's still sort of, there was a still feeling that they felt like they're seen a bit like second-class citizens, let's say, in that world. And the reason for this is that the main book fair in France is the Salon du Livre de Paris, and each year they have a guest country. And then one year, a few years back, it was the Francophonie, which was the guest country in a way. And the writers who were invited for that book fair were from everywhere in the world that where there were writers writing in French, but not from France. So in a way, it was like the Francophonie became a kind of exclusion, a way of excluding or separating or dividing writers. All the writers write in French, but some of them are French and some of them aren't. So the manifesto was to sort of try to say to the probably French literary establishment and more Parisian literary establishment or Saint-Germain-des-Prés literary establishment that, you know, there is a reason why all these writers write in French and that there's something that they can bring and that it's not necessary to always look at national identities to create a separation between French and Francophone. So, for me, I signed this manifesto not because of the sort of label literature monde or world literature that was used in that manifesto, but more because there was something to say about how I felt as that the reception of my books wasn't quite the same. For example, the libraries, or bookshops rather, would sort of put books published in France in French, but categorize them as African literature because they were written by African writers, or French writers, but of African origin, which makes it even more sort of questionable to categorize books like that. And yet, you know, Le Clézio does have origins in Mauritius, is French literature, you know, le canon littéraire français. So for me it was, and journalists or critics, when they sort of write about these books, will always mention the origin of the writer. So, and perhaps focus more on the origin of the writer rather than on what the book is about, but also the form, the stylistic form, the language of the book. So it's sort of, you sort of think, well, they're using your national identity in a way that you don't want them to do. So the reason I signed the manifesto was to say that, look, you know, you can think about literature that's written in French, you know, it's written in French or it's written in English. Language is an instrument of writing. It's not you don't categorize writers by their national identities. And but honestly, I didn't expect the manifesto to have such an impact, both negative, positive and negative, mostly negative, I think. Because, yeah, there were lots of writers who signed it, but it had it was questioned, probably because of the way it was written, and also because it questioned the idea of the Francophonie, and the organization of Francophonie took it very personally. So Mr. Abdou Diouf, who's the Secretary General of the organization, replied back. But it wasn't at all sort of, it wasn't really targeted towards this organization.
The question. No, and he didn't necessarily understand the question.
Yeah. That was, yeah. And actually, I was in an uncomfortable situation after that because I had just won a prize by the Organisation de la Francophonie. So it sort of, I had to, you know, I was invited by them to go and talk about my book, and then at the same time, people were asking me about the manifesto. So it was an uncomfortable situation. But I was able to explain it in this way, to say that it wasn't against the organization, it wasn't against, well, anything. It was really to sort of make the establishment think about how they consider writers from elsewhere, that it's no longer the sort of the poor relatives of French literature, that this writing could become, not all of it, but some of it could at some point become part of the French literary canon. With time. I mean, it's not all French writers become classical French writers, so it's the same with Francophone writing. But it's sort of to look at it in a different way. And but again, after a while, after 2 years, everywhere I was going, it was no longer a question of why do you write in French, it was a question of why did you sign the manifesto, you know? So it's sort of jumping from the frying pan into the fire. And then I had to say, well, look, you know, the idea of this manifesto is to ask people to look at the writing, at the what it's doing about literature, what it's saying about, you know, the form, the style, the content. So please ask about the content of the book rather than the manifesto. But in a way it did its job, because it created a debate. So that was probably the main issue, that it had to create a debate and to make the debate grow into something, a realization that was different from what existed.
And it's a big debate, yes. I think coming back to that issue, I mean, I threw out that character Egg, but I'm thinking of some of your other characters, and I guess it's, you know, interesting. I think that people would be interested in hearing some of your creative process. Does someone like Eve appear to you, or Josephine? And I understand your next novel, I don't know if I can say the Sari
Vert.
You have a male principal protagonist. Is it the character that comes to you first? Is it a problematic? What, you know, pulls you to that beginning of the text?
It depends. I think it's a bit different for each book, probably. With Eve de Sédécombe, in fact, it came, I was saying that my writing is more sort of like poetry writing, and Eve de Sédécombe, that title, actually came to me sort of just before sleeping, when you're in a sort of state of, you know, you're half awake and half asleep. And that's when poetry comes very often, is that it suddenly words or images appear, and you sort of find that the creative process is working while you are sort of half lucid. And these words just came to me like that, in a state of half sort of half sleep and half awake. And the next day I was thinking, oh, I'll have to write a poem starting with that Eve de Sédécombe. And as I started writing it, I thought it would be a long poem, and then I realized that it was a question, in fact. Who is Eve? Who is Eve? And what are these, well, it's rubble, basically. Décombre is rubble. And it's a title which it's not grammatical, if you like. Eve de Sédécombe, it's not a sentence, and you don't know what it means. It looks as if something is lacking in it. And the question is, what's lacking and what's happening? And I started, in a way, the writing a novel is sort of answering a question that you ask yourself. And this novel was written like that, sort of trying to answer, who's this girl, who's... What is this trouble she's coming out of or coming from? And in fact, it was a novel that I wrote like poetry, in a way, with in bits and pieces, with images coming and going. And yet, with another novel, which is called Soupir, it has a very concrete beginning. Is I read an article in a newspaper about a place, a village in a small island called Rodrigue, which belongs to Mauritius, but which is about 600 kilometers off Mauritius. And this hamlet is called Soupir, which means sigh, the sigh in English. And I was sort of started thinking, you know, what does it do to somebody who's living in a place that's called the sigh, or a place that's sighing, and who's sighing? And it's again the questions that start to sort of build up. And in a way, these questions become so important and so sort of present in you that you have to answer them, and that's when you start writing the novel. It's sort of to answer these questions. Josepha is a bit special because this is it's a very short, it's more of a novel than a novel, but it has taken sort of 20 years to come to fruition, and I got the idea when I was probably a teenager. Somebody told me a story and I just wanted to write about it, and I kept coming back to it, trying it in different forms, and it wasn't happening. And then so that novel was published in 2003, so I think it must have been in 2002, I fell ill. I had an infection, so I was feverish, and in that state of fever, and I was in bed, I suddenly sort of heard the voice of Josepha, so I took a paper and pencil and wrote sort of in a straight stream the entire novel, which I sort of reworked very little, although usually I rework quite a lot my novels. This one I reworked it very little. And I think the tone of that novel is quite different from my other novels, probably because it was written in a state of fever or feverishness, or in a second state, I don't know. So it's very different for different novels.
And you speak of different forms, and I think I'd like to come back to some of those texts, but in the different forms, because you were speaking of Eve, I know your husband has plans to film Eve, and I'm curious what you have to say about that experience you've had of transforming text to cinema, because your short story from Solstice, which is actually almost youthful, it's one of your first texts, it's a collection of short stories published in Mauritius, and 20 some years later your husband made a film that I loved, and I know we discussed this, it's the reactions of students was not the same, but how it is for you now with Ev that we were discussing of how you can put that onto the screen, how is it, because you're working with him and you've written the screenplay. What does that mean for you to transform that text to cinema? How's that experience been, and what do you expect from Ev on the screen?
Well, it was two different experiences, because with the short story, which I wrote when I was 17, and funnily enough, when I met my husband and he read that first book, I mean, a long time ago, he said, I really like that story, and if ever I make a feature film or a fiction film, because he was a documentary filmmaker, he said, if ever I make a fiction film, it will be that story. And then we just sort of let it go because he was making documentaries and all that. And then sort of 5 years ago, he decided to sort of branch out, and he said, okay, I'm going to make a fiction film. And the first thing he thought was that story, Nakatin Hal, and he said, I want to do that film. But when I started working on it for the screenplay, it was very distant from me. I mean, it's more than 30 years ago, and I just, it was like sort of something that I couldn't really connect with, because the person who wrote it is obviously completely different from the person who was doing the screenplay. And it's probably the only story of mine that's not completely dark, that has has some hope in it. And it was difficult for me to get back into it. Whereas, it's true that when he made the film, it had some hopefulness and light in it, which isn't in what I usually write. So it's quite strange how the different points of view that we have on this story. But with Ev, obviously it's much more recent. It's a story that's still within me. So when I wrote the screenplay, I was really engaged with these characters and all that. And when we started discussing it, you know, we get into these very, very intense discussions, you know, and he would say something, well, I see her like that. And I said, no, she's not like that at all, you know. And we get in arguments, but it's creative arguments, as long as it doesn't go overboard. But it's very interesting, and I find that it's a learning process for me to look at it from a completely different, from a visual point of view. And the first thing you have to do when you're writing the screenplay is sacrifice the writing, basically. You can't, the writing is poetic, but you're writing a screenplay, so you can't have too much poetry in the dialogues, you know, it wouldn't sound natural. So you have to, in a way, learn to let go and sort of say, okay, it's a different process. But the thing I found most difficult with that first film, I was there during the shooting, and there were about 30 people every day from 5 o'clock in the morning till 10 o'clock at night, all the time working together. And at some point I sort of thought, you know, I can't, you know, be with so many people all the time, because when you're writing, you're on your own, you're alone, you're in control, but also you are letting yourself go a bit with the writing. I found it, I said I would never be able to create with all these people around me. And because we were filming around the Cathedral of Port-Louis, which is the capital city of Mauritius, I would sort of from time to time nip into the cathedral and sit quietly, and you know, because you know, when there were no people there, and just let them get along with what they're doing. And it's in cinema, you know, you're so dependent on so many people. If one thing goes wrong or one person goes wrong, then you know you're losing your film, you know. So, and of course I have images of who Ev is in my mind, and that makes it difficult also, because he's doing a casting and I'm looking and he says, no, she's not Ev, you know. Well, she could be, you know. So, no, she's not Ev. So, you know, but I have also to sort of take a step back and let him relinquish the work to make it become something else. So it's no longer my baby, if you like. My baby is the published book and it's living its own life. And now this is his baby. I'm collaborating with him, but I'm not in charge of this. So I'm sort of, I'm not too proprietorial about my work. You know, if sometimes some of it has been turned into plays, and you know, I let the people do what they like within certain limits, but let them recreate something out of what's there. I think it's the life of the work that goes on. It's very exciting.
It's interesting. I mean, it's a very definitely a different mode, and I think you're most comfortable with the prose narrative. Mm-hmm. Before we get into a couple of questions about some of your novels, and I'm sure the audience here has questions to ask of you, the question also about the prose form that you've taken, because you have written a number of short stories, and there's the annual collection by Marlène Pierre-Mautou, the Collection mm-hmm. Maurice, and you've written a lot of short stories, and how does that work for you? Is a story naturally long? For you said Josephine was novella, but is something you know you enjoy continuing with the short story form, or is the longer form more natural to you?
Yeah, no, I think now it's more the longer form that's what I want to do. But so nowadays I only write short stories when they're sort of you know, asked, when you know, I have to write for an anthology and I'm asked to write a short story. So I do it more as a you know, as an exercice de style rather than let's say the initial inspiration now doesn't come to me for short stories, it's more for novels. But when I started to sort of write seriously as a teenager, discovering the form of the short story was very important because it was, for me, it was an incredible way of learning how to write, the technique of writing. Because, let's say I started earlier on writing poetry, writing tales, and then I started writing long texts when I was about 12, and I actually started writing novels when I was about 13. But then I discovered the short story through a competition that was organized by at the time it was the ORTF, which was the National Radio Television of France. And in the context of that competition, there were short stories by Maupassant, by Edgar Allan Poe that were read on the radio, and I was listening to that and suddenly discovered this form of the short story, which was which I didn't really know. And it was a complete discovery, and I started writing short stories basically for that competition. And I won a prize when I sent one of my short stories. So I wrote lots and lots of stories, and really I think that it was the best way I could learn the technique of writing by keeping it short and being in control of the characters. And even now my novels are, well, basically they're not very long, but they also don't have loads of characters. They're very often focused on one character and on a sort of line that goes from the beginning to the end. Probably mentally I'm still thinking about them almost like a short story, but then while writing them, you don't know where the novel is going to take you, and suddenly secondary characters appear that you didn't expect, or your novel pulls you in a different place. And I think that's probably the magic of novel writing, is that for those who don't plan everything, every chapter and all that, is this discovery. It's a road of discovery. And for me, the novel starts to live when suddenly it's going in a place I didn't think about it, I didn't realize it would take me. And then I know that this novel is really going to happen, or it's really living its own life. So it's a very exciting process. And I think, well, with Pugli, for example, it happened with the place name. You know, I started writing this novel thinking of writing a sort of novel of passion and of love. And in the first few lines, I was thinking of where I would set this novel. And in Mauritius, we have these wonderful place names, you know, in French or English or even in Hindi sometimes, which have a significance, a meaning. And in all my novels, the place names have an important part to play. And I was thinking, well, where will I set this novel? And suddenly I thought of Terre Rouge, which is a real village in Mauritius. And as soon as I wrote these words, Terre Rouge, I knew almost how the novel would end, that it would sort of be a sort of mud, a sea of red mud that would rise and that would drown the village and drown everybody in there. And just by writing these words, Terre Rouge, I had the end of the novel, which meant that I only had to find my way towards that end, you know, which... really, I think if I hadn't found that name there, probably wouldn't, well, it would certainly not be the same novel, but it might not even have existed. You know, you do sort of stop after a while when the inspiration doesn't go on. So that was one of the novels where this place name was important. And so for me, as a novel now is a form that I really love, and at the same time it's sort of poetry writing also, but, you know, more like it's sort of halfway sometimes between poetry and prose. But, the next novel is more, as you said, is a male character, and it's I hope it's quite different from what I usually write, because you know, you don't want to stay in the same place all the time. You want to go in different directions. And the title, Le Sari Vert, the green sari, is very sort of misleading, because you sort of have an image of softness when you hear the title. And then as soon as you go into the novel, it's a novel narrated by a very violent person, so you get into that violence immediately and you suddenly realize it's not going to take you in a comfortable place at all, you know.
And that, I think, too, is something surprising. I know that we discussed the places of such as Pagli and Troumaron of Eve, but when people see you so beautiful, so, you know, calm, and you have this violence and this psychological trauma, and you know, I discovered you through Moi l'interdite, and the what you have going on in the characters' minds, and I see Catherine Collieu here who had used this word apnée, and this kind of entre deux, and I think in Josephin you have this too, that there is an almost oppressive and also a complex sexual trauma. I mean, I don't know if that's something that, you know, you mentioned that your husband has a more positive view of things when he interprets in film, but is that your natural disposition, or is your creative person has your subconscious has that trauma of the psychological?
Yeah, maybe we should ask him whether he feels comfortable. Yeah, no, it's very strange, and I think it's been the case from the beginning that I had this dark outlook on things, on the world, and that this is what comes out in my writing. And again, to come back a bit to that short story that I wrote when I was 15 and that won a prize, I didn't show any of my writing to my parents, but when I won that prize, it was recorded on radio, and so we all, the whole family, sat around the radio to listen to it, and I was very proud, and I saw my parents' face sort of falling as they listened to it, because it was such a sad and tragic and violent story, and it was a shock for them. And it was only at that time that I realized they saw me in a way, and the writing was completely different, and it's been the story of my life, let's say, since then, that I'm seen in a way and the writing is different. Basically, I think it's two different people, you know, that you have. I have within myself somebody else who's a writer and who's relentless and who unflinchingly goes where people don't want to go. And then, I mean, I sort of think that I'm quite different, yeah, very different when I'm writing, because I'm fearless of anything. And I can't really explain it, but I think probably it's everybody is double, you know, is dual, but then I've used this duality to turn it into something creative without realizing it, without doing it consciously, and perhaps this is what makes me very calm in real life, is that I've sort of evacuated all the violence in a different way through the writing. And of course, creativity is very often violent, can be an act of where you are going to places where, you know, people don't usually go. You want to tear apart the fabric of things, and you want to really show things the way your inner eye, if you like, sees things. And when I read this story about the island Rodrigue, if you go to that island, it's wonderful, because the people are very, very welcoming, and they'll, you know, open their doors for you. So when I read that story, which was very violent, about Soupir, our common friend Edouard Monique, who really likes what I write, but that novel, he hated it, and he said, Rodrigue is not like that, you know, it's so peaceful, so calm, the people are not murderers. And so I sort of said, well, you know, it's a novel. And then some time later, I sort of saw a headline in the papers where it said, meurtre à soupir, you know, sort of murder in soupir, and it made me sort of both jump and at the same time sort of have a little snigger and say, well, you see, it's not that peaceful after all. And yeah, no, I can't.
No, it was a real fait divers.
It was a real fait divers. No, I didn't inspire murder, luckily.
Just to note that Edouard Monique is perhaps the patriarch of Mauritian letters, who does appreciate your work, as many of us do. Yeah. Perhaps my last question, and I think people would like to hear you read a little, would be something that's come up with my students that I've seen elsewhere and we discuss is, and I don't know if it's easier for you, living as what we say in the diaspora, it's easier for you to write transgressing about certain sexual and gendered ideas in Mauritius when you're outside of the country, but it seems that with Eve and with Indian Tango, which is available here, the paperback has just come out, you are going places that are not necessarily comfortable for certain people, and it seems, and I've seen this with students, a very clear reaction that's different between many women writers and men writers. And I don't know if you have something to remark on that. Have you noticed that, or if there's something? I mean, I guess it's the inevitable feminist question, but I think that I've seen readers, male readers, who aren't reading you, and.
I don't know. I don't think it's a question of male or female writing. Well, I'm not aware that. I mean, I know that a book like Josepha Le Fou made people uncomfortable, both male and female readers, quite. But it's an uncomfortable book. But the idea of transgression and all that is something that has been there also a long time, even from my first novel onwards. I must say, at the time I started writing, in Mauritius, the women writers were writing mainly historical novels or poetry, and it was, and even male writers also, it was always writing in the 70s that was very sort of, that didn't touch on the issues of society, on poverty, on real issues. And so I, when I wrote my first novel, which was Rue La Poudrière, which I started in Mauritius and then finished when I was in Africa, and it's about a prostitute of the capital city of Port-Louis, and I told that story in the first person, saying, I, writing about this prostitute, and it made people very, very uncomfortable. And the book was published in Africa, and when we they contacted distributors in Mauritius to say, well, you know, it should be read by Mauritians, and do you want to import it and to sell it there? And some of the people who read it said, you know, no, it's not right for Mauritius, you know. And for a long time, the book wasn't available actually in Mauritius. So for me, it was again this eye on society that sort of goes beyond the appearances. And in particular, a country like Mauritius, where you have this, they want to create this facade of harmony, of the rainbow nation, of the to attract tourism and to attract, they don't want anybody to show what's really happening. So, in a way, for the writer isn't there to write about tourism or to write to sort of attract tourists. So you want, on the contrary, to show what's happening. And to me, it was always it was necessary. I couldn't do otherwise than to go where people didn't go and to talk sort of about people whom nobody wanted to talk about or wanted to listen to. So, you know, in a way, this was the process in all of my writing is, and slowly, with this idea of sexual transgression, it's become also an issue that people, you know, taboo issues that people don't want to talk about, and yet they exist, and yet they're there, so you want to sort of, again, show how people see things from a certain point of view, and then when you delve a little bit deeper inside who the human being is, then you find something completely different. With Indian Tango, it was, well, the idea of it, the transgression by a woman who's sort of of this sort of above 50 and who is going towards menopause, but then suddenly has a sexual awakening which is transgressive, was the idea from the start. But I was thinking of setting the story in Mauritius, but in a way, Mauritius being halfway between India and Europe, it's sort of become more liberal than India. So there aren't really that many taboos. There are things that are unspoken, but not forbidden completely. So when I thought, well, where would this woman sort of, in what kind of society she'd have to be to really have to come out of herself completely to achieve this change or this transgression, then I sort of thought of India, because that was the place where you have certain, it's at the same time a society that's changing very quickly, and you have young people who are sort of completely free in their way of behaving and acting. And then you have a certain generation that's very set in its ways. And I thought of, then that's how it came about that I set this novel in Delhi, because then this woman who was of a certain age, who's been married for 30 years, who has adult children, suddenly finds that she didn't know her own body, and she had never known what is pleasure, what is, you know, what it is to enjoy her own body. And this is a sort of awakening that takes place in a strange way in that book.
Well, they'll have to read. It's here available for them. I don't know if the English would work for the fact that,
but since I write in French, perhaps I can read a small passage in French rather, so that people hear the writer's voice. And it's a small passage from
Indian Tango.
From Indian Tango, where the woman Subhadra, the Indian woman, for the first time hears a tango. And so I'll read that.
Une musique s'élève de l'appartement du dessous. Lente et rythmée, langoureuse et vivace, Subhadra ne la reconnaît pas. Ce n'est pas une musique indienne. On y entend du piano et de l'accordéon et des rires jeunes en accompagnement. Des meubles sont déplacés parmi des ordres contradictoires. Une voix fluette, à moitié hystérique, s'écrie « I don't want to dance, I don't know how to ». Nouveau rire, une voix masculine lui répond « It takes two to tango, even in India ». Two to tango. La musique s'étire vers elle, touche une chose noueuse dans son ventre, se répand en frisottis au creux de son abdomen. Les notes basses se hasardent plus bas, les notes hautes font sourire tout le haut. Elle bouge malgré elle en réponse à tous ses vacillements. Là où plus personne n'ose s'aventurer, c'est là que la musique veut aller. Il s'ensuit un relâchement de tout son corps, une espèce d'abandon nerveux. Ce tango argentin qu'elle ne reconnaît pas fait enfin bouger une chair quasiment anesthésiée. Écoutant les pas qui martèlent le sol en bas, elle découvre qu'elle a vécu, elle, tout ce temps, sans rythme. Elle était flottante, poussée d'un endroit à l'autre, d'un jour à l'autre, sans le moindre effort de volonté. Tout ce qui en est sorti est la certitude parfaite du chemin. Mais cette musique parle, au contraire, de voix détournées, de rencontres buissonnières, de nuits passées à mourir en s'abandonnant à ses rêves pour mieux revivre dans d'autres élans et d'autres abandons. Face à tant de douce élasticité, la raideur des compromis lui semble impossible. Les rituels, les devoirs, les habitudes, l'étroitesse des bonheurs. Quelqu'un chante, Kyakabal, quelle nouvelle ? Elle ne sait quoi répondre. La ville, toute la ville a adopté le même rythme hasardeux.
Merci. And we've really seen a panoply there for the elder woman, and you have a writer character in this novel. I think it's the moment to open the floor for questions from the audience. En français, en anglais, whatever you would like. Soyez pas timide.
At first, I was going to ask it as what, who, I mean, it's very simple. Who you read, I imagine, as you speak in English and in French, who are your influences in terms of other writers, if you have any? But then as you were both speaking, I thought how insular your writing is. And I was thinking about, for me, it's not at all negative or violent. Maybe it seems to be, but I don't think it is at all. And maybe it's that insularity. So that's sort of the other, it's just my comment on your writing, which I find to be so gorgeous and the different layering. But if you do have other influences of other writers, I'd be interested in knowing.
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, I must say that although the themes are very violent, because as I said, it's a poetic language, the language tends to soften the blow, if so to speak. You know, it like sort of attracts the reader and pulls the reader into the flow of the language, and you perhaps don't realize that it's something that's what's going on is in fact very, very violent because the language softens it, as I said. So maybe, and some people do focus on the language, and so they don't, you know, really feel that it's that dark and violent. I wouldn't say sort of influences, because you know, I love many writers, and I'm not sort of constantly reading one. There are several whom I read regularly, and I would say if a name comes to mind, it's Toni Morrison, whom I really love, and J.M. Coetzee, who's the South African writer, whom I also admire a lot. Luc Lesieux was also somebody whom I discovered in the 80s when he wrote his novel Désert, and La Quarantaine, which is set in Mauritius. Désert is in Northern Africa, and these are two books that, you know, really have remained with me all this time. And I would say Albert Cohen, La Belle du Seigneur, which is really a magnificent love novel that you can read and sort of like, it's like an ocean and the ultimate love novel, if you like. So many different French and English writers I read, you know, very regularly, but I'm not sure that, you know, it's an influence per se, because we tend to sort of try to guard ourselves against being too influenced by any one writer. You know?
I will try English and then I will switch it to French. I love reading you, okay. What surprised me immensely was the power of words that you have, the fluidity of it, and the possibility of going very far in the music of words without stopping and opening many, in your writing, many chemin transitionnel, le mot m'échappe en français ou en anglais, peu importe. I realize that rêver est beau, ce que vous faites en écrivant, ce que je crois que vous faites en écrivant, that's what I'm saying, est beaucoup plus important que le rêve, c'est sans fin. Les mots vous permettent de rêver sans fin. Et la musique des mots vous emporte dans une espèce de vague. Et My question to you was, how do you survive this writing? How do you do it? How do you, don't you, because in reading you, I love reading you, but I also sink into something. Mm-hmm. Do you sink into?
I do sink into. Yeah.
Because you reach an état limite, mm-hmm. qui touche pour moi, qui touchait aussi au féminin. Hmm? Mm-hmm. So I was thinking of you while reading you with an immense plaisir, un immense plaisir. But je suis curieuse.
Quick translation for some of them. Among the comments here were the questions. I mean, you heard most of it in English, but the music of the words carried you away like a wave, and you were talking with emotivity, but for a few words that they didn't. Sorry, mm-hmm. to translate a few words.
Yeah, I think it's a mystery. I think for me, it's a mystery. And in Indian Tango, because one of the characters is a writer. I've tried to go into it also to try to, by writing about this character who's a writer, I realized that more and more I was actually trying to decode, let's say, the process of writing for myself. And at one point the writer says, why are some writers attracted to the darkness, to the dark side of things, of people? And sometimes when they are asked to explain, they'll say, well, we want to show what's wrong with the world. We want to talk about people who are not talked about. As I just said earlier, we want to talk about the violence that exists. And it's a way of sort of making known what is actually very often hidden in societies by taboos, by things they don't talk about. Or is it an attraction towards the dark? Is it a real sort of almost an attraction towards the towards violence for itself? Is it something that pulls you? Is it something that you want to wallow in almost? And the question the writer asks, I ask myself, because you sort of think, what makes you go there, want to go there? Maybe there are other paths to follow. And I was talking about Coetzee earlier. He also sometimes asks in his essays or in some of his novels, do we have the right to talk about everything? What is the writer's limits? You know, is anything open to the writer, any subject, any way of talking about things? I think these are questions. I don't think I have an answer. But it's true that often the subject pulls me in and you know, it is almost a hurt, if you like, when you're writing it and you're putting yourself in these situations, especially as I tend to write by saying I. So I find that, you know, I have to go very deep into the character and feel what the character is feeling. But at the same time, as I was saying earlier, there's also the pleasure of the writing itself, which compensates for the darkness. And there's, you sort of, and also the poetry of language is something that pulls you through, maybe. It's like something that makes you go through the tunnel and go out at the end, and go out of it. So I think maybe the three processes is what makes it livable, you know, as a writer. Yeah. Oui, mais bon, c'est ce que je disais, qu'il y a la souffrance des personnages, la souffrance d'écrire ces personnages, mais en même temps, il y a le plaisir de l'écriture et de la langue, donc je crois que tout ça, ça se mélange à un moment donné. Oui, je pense. Oui.
Plaisir de la langue châtie en anglais.
One last question. Hi, I just wanted to ask a little bit about your relationship to Creole as well as the immersion experience of Creole, and was wondering whether it might be akin in some ways to what Patrick Chamozot describes in Chemin de Colf or Martinique, where mm-hmm. French can only be learned by the denigration and the suppression of Creole, and whether your sense is that, this is not a question about why don't you write in Creole, but a question mm-hmm. about whether that sense of Creole as still being the language of orality, as opposed to French being the written language, is something that that circulates still within the kind of immersion literary imagination. On a related question, I know that you have worked on translating the Guyanese writer David Dabedin's The Counting House, and I wonder what your experience there as a translator of some of the English Creole that he does incorporate, he and other Caribbean writers try to incorporate into their writing, what that experience was like.
Mm-hmm. In Mauritius, it's still very much the case that a lot of people feel that Creole is not the language of writing or reading. A lot of people, if you go to Mauritius now, will say, I can't read Creole, because it didn't have a codified writing for a long time, and it's only been sort of gradually, a gradual sort of fight on the part of a small number of people who wanted to make it become a language of perhaps identity, of Mauritian identity, and they've sort of slowly tried to create, to use the writings that is used in Haiti or in the Caribbean, which is more of a phonetic writing. On my part, I mean, Creole is one of the languages that I have, so it's not something that I feel is in a hierarchy at all, or a hierarchical relationship with French. It's more like English, that some things do happen to me in English, and I will sort of try to write them in English, and occasionally some poetry happens to me in Creole, so I will write it in Creole, but I wouldn't force it. I wouldn't say, no, now I have to sit and write Creole. So when it happens, I do it. But again, as I said, it's become such ingrained in me to write in French that it's the first language that comes. But I do feel from time to time the need to write in Creole. And I was asked a couple of years ago to translate a small passage from Ulysses in Creole to celebrate Bloomsday in the small town where I live, and I think it's the very first time that Molly Bloom's voice was heard in Creole, so I thought I really enjoyed that very much. Translating David Dabedin was a real challenge, and because, of course, Pidgin English is something that you can understand, an English reader will read it and will still be able to understand. But if I had translated it completely into Creole, the French reader wouldn't have been able to understand it. So I had to sort of get a halfway approach where I was using the sentence structure of Creole, the grammatical structure of Creole, but using French words to translate that part. And it took me a long time to get into it, but there's a whole part of the novel which is written in that Creole English language, and once I got into that flow, it came. But I'm not sure that I completely succeeded. That I did a sort of, maybe that novel could be. I mean that translation could be improved. I wasn't sort of completely happy with it when I finished because of that halfway approach I had to use. But this is also the novel that made me decide I wouldn't work as a literary translator, because it sort of takes too much place, in sort of inside you. It sort of becomes a parasite of yourself, and after that I stopped doing literary translation. I went into scientific and technical translation, which was much more comfortable.
I heard a big oh no when I said it was the last question, so I just have to take a very last one here.
Okay.
I guess my question for you, Ananda Devi, is in the process of writing your characters, your male characters, how do you go about to transvestite yourself, to actually imagine them, give them life, and imagine their masculinity in your novels?
Well, I think that, as I was saying earlier, when I said that it's two people, you know, the writer and the person who's sort of sitting here and talking, is that I do think that the writer doesn't have, I mean, is almost sexless in a way and adopts or without identity of his or her own, and that you, in a way, you sort of adopt the identity of the narrator, especially if you're talking, saying I. And so for me, this is how it happens, is that I have to find that voice within me, and which was what with Josephin was difficult, is that I had to find his voice. Perhaps which is why there are fewer male narrators across my novels than female narrators. But the next one that's coming out is a male narrator, is a horrible, horrible man of 80 years old. And it's strange, because once you get into that kind of mindset, it was almost enjoyable. I was having fun writing against women, and you know, from a male chauvinist perspective. So I did have, I mean, in a way, it's almost fun to sort of change yourself completely. So maybe that's the, again, that's the pleasure of writing, is that you can be anything you want and anybody you want, even somebody who's completely at sort of diametrically opposed to you.
Well, Ananda, Thomas, thank you so much for this wonderful, wonderful time. We're selling some of Ananda's book that she'll be happy to sign for you. I thank you very much for being here tonight. If you're not members of FIAF, you might want to pick up a brochure on membership, as we have an amazing series starting in May that is called World Nomad, specifically on Haiti. So a lot of language and issue will be discussed then. It's a multidisciplinary series, so please come to that. And come back, and thanks again for being here tonight.